So basically, I wanted to introduce you to a yoga that I mentioned yesterday in my talk, and which I call the yoga on harmonic of harmonic resonance, and to a second type of yoga, which is which I also developed in the course of my life early on. Which I call the yoga of infinite space. And these are two yoga that I was, by my connections, you know, on when I was meditating and when I was on a sacred site, because we are talking a lot about sacred sites here in Megalithomania. Because of this traveling to so many countries and systematically visiting the sacred site in each one, I develop a specific yoga of connection for both that are both linked to also how you can get in touch more deeply with the sacred site. So the yoga of harmonic resonance, I'm going to say again how I discover it. I was hitchhiking between 16 and then I went to India, I was 21, hitchhiking from Iran. And then I hitchhiked all the way through Africa, from Montségur to India again. And again in India, I made the big round hitchhiking and staying in a sacred site. And so I was hitchhiking very early on. At one point, I stopped at a church that is on the way to Normandy. And there was an harmonium, and I love to play and to get, you know, those harmoniums in the church. They were open at that time. So you could get in a church in the middle of the afternoon, which you cannot do anymore now. And you could basically, even one time, in one place, I got the key of the organ. I was able to play. Improvise on the organ. So I had this harmonium, and then I went to do this specific meditation, which I, at that time I knew already had to be exactly under the center of the dome of the church. And so basically, when you have an architecture, whatever is the style of architecture, whatever country you are in, the sacred architecture, the architecture for temples or very sacred places, unless we are at the megalithic time where you have only the basic antenna, which is a standing stone coming out, you know, and always with a vertical form, a shape, and you have the other one, the yin. So the yang and the yin, which is the underground chamber, a dolmen, you know, with a huge, huge table. So one is pointed on making an antenna. And of course, it's simplistic to say yin-yang, especially when, men and women are able to, at the same time, meditate on making an antenna, and meditate on grounding themselves. So in terms of the psyche and spiritual evolution, of course, this is not the way to look at things. We are more sophisticated, but we can say one energy is ascending and making antenna, and the other energy, the chamber, the underground chamber, is grounding with the and receiving and participating to the energy of the earth, the telluric energy. So telluric means specifically related to earth as a crust, a planet on the ground. Cosmic, of course, are the energy coming from the cosmos and specifically the stars. And so we are going to see these types of energy. And the third type of energy is, in terms of this, is what I call semantic, having to do with meaning, having to do with consciousness, the creation of meaning. C'est-à-dire the semantic energy is the energy we use to think, and it is also the type of energy, and it's everything, you know, your semantic energy. I call it your semantic field, your consciousness. You are mind, body, psyche. You have all kinds of flavors. And within your semantic energy are also the emotions. When you feel, you give meaning to something. And when you react, even instinctively, it's still on the base of a meaning for maybe your instinctive being. So all this, everything we are based in has to do with meaning. There is even when we utter a word, when we react, when we have emotions, when we have ideas, intellectual ideas, they are all connected to all the other levels of your body. Sometimes you react with 3/4 of your body and a little bit of intellect. And sometimes it's the opposite, but you don't have one thing you don't have is an idea that is devoid of emotion and body feeling. And this is very important to understand. And this is a theory in cognitive science that I developed, which is called theory of semantic field theory, because it's like taking the whole person as a multi-level one system. So to get back to the energy, the sig, semantic, I take the S, sigma in Greek, and I call it sig with a Y. Sig energy, in short, is the energy of consciousness. So the third type of energy we have when we are gathering now in those sacred places is the energy that we bring as a full person, you know, mind, body, psyche. And this energy is able to connect with the other people. And we create a kind of harmony field between our consciousness, especially when we are in rituals, especially when we are in a shared state, you know, like we are listening, we are at a concert, listening to the concert. We create a kind of harmony field between all the people listening. This can happen also in when we are in making some rituals, trance rituals everywhere in the world. Let's remember that all shamanic cultures from the past had rituals, you know, collective rituals on all the cult, possession cult, you know, in Africa and Brazil. They all had collective rituals of trance. That trance was everywhere on the planet. Hmm? So the third type of energy, I repeat myself, is the sig energy, I call it. And sig energy is going to have different types of imprinting, but this is the type of imprinting in it. It is imprinted in the atmosphere, in the prana, you know, in the air. The Hindu concept of prana has to do with an energy which is in the cosmos and in our atmosphere, specifically on Earth. And when we breathe this energy, we are able to get inside ourselves the energy from the cosmos. So if you want, we are going to make a little exercise to try to bring the prana and breathe it inside us. For then you can use it any way you want for healing. So this is the energy of the earth. This has to do also with the grounding energy. It's like taking in the energy from the cosmos, from the earth. So the Sig energy, above and beyond that, is the energy of intelligent beings, namely us humans, you know, but always remember we are not alone. And this energy of consciousness is imprinting not only the prana, and that's what is creating the Akashic records, you know. The Akashic records in some texts, yeah, Hindu texts, are specifically connected with prana. And they say at the beginning of the universe, there was only prana having the whole information of the universe. And at the end of the universe, of a universe, in a chain, in a collar of universe, like we have in Hinduism, you know, on the Vedic tradition, at the end of the universe, you have only prana also. So I'm not going to get into this because it would be too long and out of our subject. But what I mean is that prana for the Hindu is not only the energy of consciousness, a cosmic consciousness that you can breathe through the air with some specific yogic techniques that are called prana yoga, the yoga of the prana energy, which is a breathing yoga. But you can also you have it in any type of matter system, and I believe until the particles. So the whole universe is imprinted by the conscious evolution, the conscious civilizations, and then of course you take all planets and all that as being also conscious being, you know, whatever the type of consciousness. You don't need a brain, you don't need a... And when we are in a ritual, and we are able, normally the ritual in any culture, the ritual should be able to bring out a very strong interconnection between the people. If they are not able to do that, and you are just sitting there and waiting for the time to pass, to get out of wherever you are, it means that this ritual is no more alive, because you should be happy, you know. It's like in some culture you have burying somebody is a great feast, because okay, this person had a great life and we are going to say goodbye and we stay connected and voilà. So the rituals of the ancient culture, which were all of them with trance and dance and music and upbeat, you know. Even in Hinduism, you have the puja, you in the great feast. You know, you can get to a puja. You see some ascetics and some people, they are just sitting on the ground and they are playing, they are improvising music. And you can come by and they say, come, you want to come, you want to sit, you want an instrument, you want to play? Oh, yes. And it's very upbeat. It's like you are chanting mantras, and at the same time, you are getting in trance with the people there, and you are under a tree in the middle of the street in whatever town, you know, in the 70s. Now it's a little more difficult. So three great energies that are in a kind of temple. So I'm going to make a little I have to use it because I put it. So basically, you have the very schematic thing is that here you have a steeple or an obelisk, and that's why you have the Ben stone, which was the most sacred part of the obelisk. Ben stone is the pyramidion. It's a tiny pyramid on top of an obelisk. And it was, it had inside, and we know that because in Paris, something like late 70s or early 80s, suddenly we heard that somebody had stolen the gold sphere that was inside the pyramidion of the obelisk at Concorde. And it was under the Mitterrand. And so they knew about everything about this because Mitterrand was a Freemason. And so they were able to, they had to redo, to make another gold, pure gold sphere and put it back inside our pyramidion. Speaking, this is interesting. So this is the antenna, en fait. So the antenna here is taking the energy from the cosmos and distributing it again, you know.
Can I ask you a question?
Say, yeah.
The gold sphere, is that an ancient thing or is that a more modern thing?
Very ancient. Because our obelisk in Paris, it comes from the Karnak, you know. So it was they are the tallest. They were the couple of tallest obelisk in Egypt, and we were given one. But at the same time, we have to remember that Napoleon, and I correct something that has been said yesterday, I don't remember by whom, but Napoleon was the one to, when he made his Egypt campaign, he brought with him scientists to be able to make a new all rapport about the culture, the monuments and everything. And he started with those scientists, they started the field of archaeology. It's the first time when they came in Egypt, the Sphinx had the sound until about practically its nose. And they were the one so Napoleon went back after his campaign and he left the scientist on site, on different sites, and they were the one to take the sound out and to start showing that those monuments were so extraordinary that we had to take care of. That started the field of archaeology. So very early 19th century. So basically you have, yes, we were given the obelisk, but the problem is that now this is the node, the absolute node of Paris. And there is absolutely, you know, you have something very, very strange in terms of sacred architecture on the connection between sacred sites in the world. Yesterday I was recounting a story where in Montségur I went to meditate on a sacred site where at a specific spot on the hill where I felt I was called by myself alone when my friend had gone, and I discovered those rays like 6 or 7 rays extending something like this, which I measure was about 120 degrees. And those rays were connecting Montségur with outside of the castle, maybe 15 kilometers bird fly flight, and they were connected to a northern hemisphere sacred sites, namely the first line was they were straight like laser line, you know, and the first one was Glastonbury. The first one was Glastonbury. And the most eastern one, because I'm south of France in the Pyrenees, Montségur, the Qatar place, and basically, you know, the hill was facing Glastonbury and India, Ellora, and the Kailash on the same line because they are turning around the earth. So there is something, the Montségur state that I discovered those lines were from very ancient, and it was a seat, you know, in the middle of the hill that was still marked by semantic energy. So even if you don't have a rock, you had a hill, you know, which were very sacred for the Celtic people. And this was dating from at least the Celtic people or the people of the megalith. Nevertheless, there was no stone, but it was a seat of power where one person, one initiate, used to sit and connect with initiates from different cultures and religion. And this, I believe, at least what I, the sites that were connected go back 8,000 years, at the minimum. The oldest Celtic stone we have in Karnak, the dolmen, the table, you know, the huge table, and underground chamber under the table, they are dated, the oldest one, 6,000 BC. So there was, in my opinion, a kind of connections going on all the time between initiates, and they were not inside the specific sacred building of a specific religion. Why? Because they were beyond, in time, they were beyond a specific space. That's why they were not in the castle of Montségur, which was destroyed, where people were burnt by the hundreds. During the beginning of what was going to be 4 centuries of Inquisition. They were not inside sites that could be at one point destroyed to put another god and another religion in its place, and always at the same place. So basically you have a sacred site where you have this energy, and sometimes you have the cave under, which is, for me, a J-spot, and here ascending and grounding spot. This is connected with the earth. And this is connected to the cosmos, because what's happening is that your energy, let's say, for example, you have a Concorde pyramid, the obelisk, and here you have a church, for example, Notre Dame. It's not very nice, but it's okay. And basically, you have kind of arcs of light that are coming out and coming in the top of the steeple, and the energy is going on the next node in the network. And it's going like that. It's like, you know, when you are under a dome and you make a meditation, specifically under the dome, if you can. Now, of course, they put the altar and you cannot, but so you make this meditation like that, and you emanate a ray from your head chakra, you ground yourself very nicely, and you emanate a ray. And then you are able to go through the dome. If you connect with the wall structure, maybe you are able to go through the dome. And then it's like something like 5 or 6 yards above the dome, wherever is the dome, you will feel that your ray of light is spreading geometrically, always geometrically. And you may have a crossing of four, or of two lines, like four vectors, or you may have a crossing of 8, 12 on huge building. And you can follow each line. And you can, in a site you don't know, a tiny church somewhere. One time, for example, I was able to feel that there was four lines, I mean four vectors, you know. So I could say, okay, there is one, and then it's going there, and this one here, and going there. Then I go outside, I was in Provence on a tiny steep hill, and I remember that I had felt, you know, this direction, tac, tac, and the opposite. And I go outside of the hill, of the church, on the hill, which I can turn around the church very easily. And I find this direction, oh yes, there is a church there, like next village, you know, say half a mile, sometimes 500 yards, 300 yards, depends. It depends if it is very populated or not. And oh yes, here is a little cross. Oh yes, and maybe the fourth one is not existing anymore. You have this. So the line is broken. But I must tell you that I'm astonished that in France you have so few lines that are broken. Because if the stone is, if your dolmen or your menhir that was here has been destroyed, or the, you know, which doesn't happen very often in France, apart from stupid, crazy priests that decided to go on a crusade and destroy the megalith, as you know happened. But apart from this exception, we have those stones have been able to survive. I'm sorry, we have nothing to do with that. I think they were so strong that they did survive. So the sacred sites always survive. And when you have a line that is broken, it's first of all, it's very rare. It's not on major axes. It's always a tiny, you know, one line. And because it's true that you need the stone. It's better to have a stone. This kind of arcs. Your SIG energy can imprint even the ground, you know, anything. But for those arcs to create the sacred network between on the country, you know, the best is a monument, the best is a stone. The best is an antenna on the ground chamber. And then steeples, domes, every type of architecture that you have. But.
Can I ask a question there? In the UK, there's been a lot of sort of Methodist type churches.
So a lot of?
Methodist churches.
Sure.
Which don't tend to be sort of in a form with a steeple and so forth. And some of those were built probably about 120, 150 years ago. Would they have the same ability to connect energy?
They don't have steeple?
Well, I'm just trying to think.
Is that ever pointed something?
I suppose they possibly do, but it's not as pronounced as a normal cross. Sorry?
Might have a cross.
Yeah, the cross. Yeah. That's it.
Some might have a little bell, too.
You know, I mean.
Yes,
yes. Even a dome, you know, for example, the Muslim architecture everywhere, you have a dome, okay, or Roman architecture, Roman arcs, you know. Even this, even if you don't have, which you have on all domes in Islam architecture, you know, you have always a pointed little something here with a round and a point. okay? Maybe three rounds, you know, in different size, and then the point. Even if it is tiny, this is the key. It's like your Ben song. It's this is the one that is making the antenna on the wall dome. On the wall architecture is, as the Egyptian knew well, this is why the Ben stone was extremely sacred. And the Ben stone is coming from Sumer. Eh? We have it in the Sumerian tradition as this shape, exactly the shape of a shem, which is also the rocket interplanetary vehicles, but also the shape of a perfect antenna, pyramidion, or you have it in the stupa in Nepal, in Buddhist culture, stupa, beautiful. Like you have you may have a square like this in Nepal, for example, and then you have something round, maybe at different levels, you know, and then a point. Or you have a shape like that on a square. And this is a stupa. And they are everywhere on the road. They seem to be in the middle of nowhere. But they are on very specific spots. So once you have understood that basically you have those two shapes, remember the cave, and then the antenna shape, then you can understand the whole the creation of a world network that was created by the people, what we call the people of the megalith, a people whom we don't know where who they were, nothing. Just as they erected the megalith, and in my opinion, they created the blueprint of our sacred network on Earth. Yes?
The churches.
What?
The builders of the churches on those sacred sites, they clearly understood those. Are they the sort of the masons who understood
sure.
the network and just built,
yes.
just put their own
of course.
On top of it?
Of course, that was the les bâtisseurs, you know, the builders.
Yeah.
The builders of churches and the cathedrals in France. Not at the moment that the Gothic style is arriving, we have three builders, guild. And these three builders' guild, I believe,
yeah.
is why they were called free masons. Because they were building and they were outside of the church. So you see the arrival with the companion. And before you have the free mason, you have guilds of builders, guilds of stone. Carver on wood carvers on the guilds of this and that, and they are kind of hierarchical organization with, as I believe, at the top you have the architect, of course, and then I believe you have the Freemasons taking the name of the most important people below the architect. And so what I think happened, so in before that you had the orders of monks, each order building its own abbeys and monasteries and all that. So we have Saint Bernard and we have all kinds of people that were of orders who had a very specific architectural style, and which some of them opposed the new Gothic style, you know. And that's why in the Gothic cathedral you have, you see well that you don't have the orthodoxy of the Catholic Church. I'm sorry, I'm taking the example I know. Eh? I don't know about Methodist Church. So I'm talking about what I know. And we have in the cathedrals, Catholic cathedrals in France, we have all kinds of sculptures that are not at all, would not be agreed upon by the évêque or the bishop of the place, you know. We have alchemists, we have the Queen of Sheba with Solomon. Well, that's biblical, it's okay. And you will remark, I make a little parenthesis, which is very interesting. You will remark that on two or three cathedrals I have seen, either on picture or on de visu, notably Chartres, the Queen of Sheba is of same head, the head just at the same level as Solomon, always next to Solomon, her husband, okay? Okay, Solomon is here, let's say, Queen of Sheba is here, but if their head is at the same level, which already is strange, you have the Queen of Sheba feet that are at least 35 centimeters below the feet of Solomon. And this means that the Queen of Sheba was from the descent of the Anunnaki. I'm sorry, this is a totally different book. I had it yesterday called DNA of the Gods. She has the DNA of the giants, but we were talking about giants in this conference. Eh? She was a very tall person, and you have this information if you look. You know, if you don't look at the head, and suddenly you look at the feet, it's something strange. Because he was tall already, compared to the saints and all that. So, not only that, we have the Greek philosophers on the cathedrals, you know. Among the non-Catholic dogmatic people that are populating the cathedrals, you have all kinds of interesting characters. The alchemist is on Notre Dame de Paris. We have the alchemist on the roof. And they are always, you know, placed at the key post, key points in the architecture. It's funny. And we have also Marie, la Juive. We had some extremely strange sculpture with a woman, very young, who have three loaves of bread, one on top of the other, of course, perfectly round. It's like she has absolutely nothing to do with, she was a kind of philosopher or something. Maybe the philosopher Catherine of Alexandria, I don't know. So what happened is that what I believe is that you have this very, very enigmatic people that were knowing everything about Earth energy and the geomagnetic field, and they started putting in place those megaliths. And so you have the lines of geomagnetic field, as I said, you know, they are undulating vertically, as I said yesterday, sorry. And they are, of course, totally modified by the mountains as one person was explaining everything about the geomagnetic field. And it was extremely precise what he did. And it's true, the mountains, the rivers, every feature of the terrain is modifying the geomagnetic field lines. And notably, they move on top of mountain and they are attracted by the top of the mountain. And that's why we have the shape of the temple as an antenna, okay? So they erect buildings where you have a crossing with ascending lines, crossing above the ground, and they erect underground chambers, tables, for the points that are grounding energy, where when the energy lines are kind of crossing underground. Let's say this is the ground, okay? And this is a J point, grounding point, and so your magnetic field is going, and of course it's going always. And when you have a crossing, when you have only a line alone, you know, it can do that, you know. So, but if you have a megalith here, this is the ground. If you have a megalith here, it will take the line, the telluric line, it will take it up like this. And then when you have a church, it will take it even upper. And if you have a Tour Eiffel, something very, very tall, antenna, then you have an extremely high line, which means that in a town, this field is so dense that basically, if you are in the middle of the desert, I would say that a big telluric line, which some of them I've seen were like 1.20 meters wide, you know, they are like a huge cylinder, you know, and they move up the ground, like they go like 300, 500 yards in the desert, and they plunge inside the earth, and then they go again 500 yards under the ground, and then they move again, and they turn around the earth. So those are the telluric lines. They are like a huge cylinder, you know, going like that. And when you are inside the flow, it's enormous. I've seen an enormous one in New Jersey once I was in a conference. And I have seen another one in Cannes, in the south of France. And this is the two times where I felt such an enormous, like one this big, you know, kind of flow, you know. Normally they are like that. So I believe that the megalith people, when they had a crossing of four lines, when they had just a little crossing of one, you know, they put a tiny stone. When they had a crossing of four and then eight vectors, you know, four lines making eight vectors. We have this in Paris network. It's absolutely perfect. Two crosses, you know, the perfect flaming cross of the Sumerians. The flaming cross of the Sumerian, it's a perfect cross like this with straight arms. And the two other arms are undulating. Oh. And this is the most, the most sacred symbol in Sumer is the flaming cross. It's a symbol of the great gods, the 12 great gods corresponding to constellations. When you had a crossing of four lines making a perfect cross, so in Paris, I will show you the picture, on d'Enfer Rochereau, you have not only perfect 90 degree angles, but another one crossing also, I'm sorry, I did it undulating, but it's not, it's perfectly straight. You have a perfect two crosses. And you have one or two other ones. And under this place, Plaza d'Enfer Rochereau, which is in grossly in the south, under Montparnasse, on this plaza, you have the caves, and you had the place where the Christians at the time of the Roman invasion the Catholic Church before the 4th century was not accepted by the Roman. And the first Christians, they were hiding in the catacomb, we call them. And you have them also catacomb in Roma. So these are the places of worships, hidden rituals of the first Christians. Mm-hmm. At the time, they were not yet, you know, one dogma. Each Gnostic sect had its own rituals and dogma, as you can read in the Gnostic Gospels. Okay, so when you had a very, very strong point like this, then you build an enormous temple, whatever, you know. So that's why on those enormous temples, generally, the biggest one, what are now the cathedrals in the West, they have a double node. They have the antenna, and they have the underground chamber. So they are double node. So these 8 vectors, these 4 lines crossing, you have it on top and underground. On top of the steeple or whatever is there, and underground. This is why, and because the people of the megalith were putting, it's like they were putting markers for us, you know. This, you had 2 main energies. The first energy is lines crossing above ground, like the 2 waves are going like this, and they cross above ground before to go back inside again, okay? So you have 2 types of crossing.
I missed where the crossing was of the flaming cross in Paris. Where does it cross?
This?
Yeah.
This is the flaming cross.
What is at that site in Paris?
D'Enfer Rochereau. You have 2 places where you have this. And the other one. Ah. Somebody took the. But why you did not? But wait.
It's in the book, isn't it? I thought they went in there, but.
No, but it is.
I know it's in the book.
No, it's yours. It's yours.
No, it was in the other one.
Oh, it's okay. There is no problem. It's just that I should have them here too. It doesn't matter. Look, it doesn't matter. So I'm going to pass this around. well, I will show you after, okay? Okay, I will show you after. You have 2 places in Paris with 4 absolutely straight lines with 2 types, two crosses embedded in each other, each one with perfect 90 degrees. One of them being a perfect meridian and parallels, 2 of them.
Are the lines the same dimensions? Are they the same thickness or are they different or length?
Can you feel that? They may be of different size, I don't know. Eh? What I know is that when I look at a cathedral, when I look at, I'm driving, and I look, whatever the weather, you know, if it is cloudy, not cloudy, doesn't matter. I see the top of buildings and I'm passing by, you know. And if Paris is in a healthy, nice state, the Parisian and everything, you have the energy streaming out of all the roof of everything. So basically you have you have a Tour Eiffel, you have the cathedral, you have a round dome, and they all, you see those energy. like this. You see? And you see those streams of whitish, bright light. And this is when, well, most of the time, when the sacred network is in Paris, because it's breathing in the wall of Earth, you know. But on the once, two times in my life, I saw the network totally broken on something like, I started in on the Loire Valley, you know, where I was living. And the network was totally broken on Blois, and then I moved to Paris. It was totally broken, and that was extremely serious problem was happening in the world.
When was that?
2004. We had a very, very serious problem.
So how was the problem resolved then?
Eh?
How was it resolved?
I think people got into meditation and created again as the kind of harmony field that I call Telar field. Telepathic harmonic field, on the meditated on the building, and were able to make the energy flow again, you know. But these are things now. Maybe I will get into that if you like, the psychological aspect of the sacred network. This is the stone aspect. So I finish on that, and we get on the other one, and which is why in this book you have two parts in the books, grossly, because you have a third one. But basically, you have half of the book, which is the second half, is on the sacred network in terms of energy lines and architecture, as we saw, and the first part of the books is about harmony field, how we connect with people, what we are supposed to do when we are at a ritual inside a sacred building, whatever the age, whatever the religion, you know, what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to create a very strong consciousness field that is going to imprint with consciousness energy the whatever, temple, stone, whatever, outside the tree, giant tree, outside clearing with the Native Americans, you know, sacred tree, wherever we are, it should imprint our consciousness energy in this sacred building or stone, and we receive from this stone the consciousness energy, the SIG energy that has been imprinted since ever, since the time it was built, and even before. And we are, because we are at the crossing of a Cosmo-Telluric line, we are connecting ourselves to the whole planet. If the network is alive and strong, flowing from one country to the next, we are breathing in an energy that is turning around the planet and making us, allowing us to breathe on the spiritually also, bodily and spiritually.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, maybe we stop between the two.
What's the difference between the upper lines and the lower lines?
Sorry? There is no difference. It's the same energy. I call it SIG energy, because it's also an energy that is the same as our energy of consciousness. Again, it's you have one. I believe you have one type of energy that is not only electromagnetism. It is based on the geomagnetic field, which is, of course, carrying electromagnetic energy. But the Sieg energy is something that has to do with consciousness in the universe, that same energy that allow us to think and feel and have emotion and react. So I believe that we have, and this is what I'm tackling now with this cosmology theory, I believe we have in the universe another type of energy. You know that the electromagnetic spectrum takes all the energies that we know, from a microwave with your cell phone to gamma rays coming from the sun, you know, the cosmic winds and all that. from the lowest energy to the highest frequencies, this is all electromagnetic, the spectrum, EM spectrum. I believe that we have another type of energy that we have not discovered yet, which is, I call Sieg energy. You have to give a name, it doesn't mean anything. But it is related to consciousness. And this is the prana of the Hindu. And I believe that this is how, because this Sieg energy is not limited by the speed of light, like all electromagnetic energy. And this is why you are able to connect by telepathy and to connect from the stars, you know, how they can get information. And this is, if you imagine a very high technology civilization in the cosmos that has been able to tame this kind of Sieg energy, whatever they call it, then they would be able, this is my science fiction, I imagine that they have this energy and what kind of technology you can get. I imagine that if they would have camera, that when they take a film, a video, they have one layer of the video which has to do with what is inside the head of people. You understand? The consciousness, because it's an energy linked to consciousness, if they take a video with this type of energy, they would have the inside event happening inside the consciousnesses of people. They would be able to decode, looking at the video, what was your thought at that moment. You know, what did you had in mind? You understand? So that would be very interesting. And of course, they would be able to display themselves in time and space.
Isn't it said that as the Aquarian Age progresses, that will be one of the skills we'll have?
You have to say that again.
As the Aquarian Age progresses, that's a very long track of time, obviously, that will be one of the skills that will be
yes.
Normal.
Yes.
Well, what's this other energy that you're referring to?
What?
Haven't named.
I gave a name because I know from my different fields of research. I started by parapsychology, you know, working at a laboratory at the US, making some experimental, helping pre-doctoral, helping on some experiments on telepathy. And it's evident we had statistics showing that telepathy was existing. So how can you explain telepathy without having, and especially healing? We have a field that has been able to show 150 experiments on healing, meaning bio-PK, and we know for certain that the mind can have an influence on biological matter. So at that point, what kind of energy can be quicker than light, not stopped by Faraday cage and the EM screening, you know, cage or whatever, You can have telepathy with somebody inside a submarine. So you have an energy that is not of the nature of electromagnetic energy. You have an energy that is quicker than light, faster than light energy, FLT. You have an energy that is not carrying information like your little microwave is carrying your voice on the phone. It is itself, the energy is itself meaning. It's not a carrier wave. So you have a faster than light, non-EM type of energy that is itself consciousness and information. So it's like a set of frequencies instead of one frequency, one wave with one amplitude.
I think the theosophists call that Fohat. Hmm? That same energy, the theosophists call Fohat.
Fohat?
It's an extraterrestrial cosmic energy.
I've never seen that. I studied theosophy. I've never seen this.
How about the explanation from quantum mechanics, quantum physicists?
Then you look on the internet. It's not a subject. We are going to go too far. If this energy exists, in one sentence, if this, whatever it's called, energy that is faster than light, non-EM, which is itself consciousness, operating active information, like Bohm says. If you have this energy in the universe, and this is why we're able to think and feel, then you have a whole layer of reality that we have not discovered with our science. And that would explain everything, including some anomalies on the in quantum physics, like the EPR paradox, where you have the particles, photons that are able to communicate at a distance faster, immensely faster than light. So now, now if you put me on this subject, I'm gone. Because what is difficult is to get back to this. I'm just saying one sentence. Okay, is that? Well, I forgot it, so forget it. I think it's better.
You know your points, what he was asking about the times, you said the times are the same.
What did you say?
He was asking about both the difference in above ground and below ground light.
Yeah,
they're the same, but the lower points where they meet underground are like hearing points, you said?
The lower?
Where they meet underground, like the caverns under the antennas, and they're the hearing points.
The healing points.
The ones above, you said the ascending points. What
properties cosmic. Okay, so let's take 5 minutes because this is very interesting. You think they are going to stop me at the airport because I'm carrying some kind of new drug, a green one? They are very sorrow, you know. It's going to be very strange for them. Okay. So we are going to make it smaller so that we can see the bigger picture. So I believe that you have, when you have four lines like this, you understand that what's happening is that a line is coming, it's falling on your steeple. At that point, it's going underground, and it's getting up on the next little cross or stupa or whatever. And another one is going up like this and going down on the first monument steeple. So you have to understand they move up and down vertically. So and in the desert, like 300, 500 yards for one amplitude. And in towns, you can have sometimes 10 meters between one steeple and the next. Depends where you are, you see. So it's kind of making them more dense. And so you imagine that. And on a very big double architecture with a lot of lines, like four lines crossing, like, for example, Drancy Rochereau, what this place, Plaza in Paris, or Notre Dame, you have the crypt, and you have the building, and the dome, and the steeple, okay? At the minimum, okay? Because it's much more complex. And that's why I use... okay. So, and you have the crypt here. So, you have some of the lines that are coming from underground, from this point here. Let's put another point, another node here, and another node here. Maybe here you have also a cave. So you have basically, you have one energy that may be coming like that, and then it's going to be up like this. And then the other one from the steeple here is going like that. Normally it would go like that, and then it's going like that. But because you have your high steeple here, this energy from the steeple here, the small steeple, will go like this. Plouf. And then part of the energy will follow the architecture lines and get into the ground. You have to understand it's like oxygen for the earth, or for the network. It's like an energy from the cosmos, nourishing the earth and us, and our bodies, and our minds, and our psyche.
So it's absorbed by the earth, it doesn't continue.
It is
the energy that comes in is absorbed by the earth, doesn't continue.
Yeah, no, it's always continuing. Here, first of all, it's going, it's all always flowing.
Oh.
It's always flowing, and the flow is always going straight, and simply it is going more up or more down, or attracted by the crypt, attracted by the summit of the steeple, and then it follows the line of architecture. It's going to go down the arcs, the Gothic arcs or the Roman arcs, and then it's going to be going into the earth, you know?
This, I think a lot of what you're saying is about your own human sensibility to these waves.
Cannot be otherwise.
but I'm just trying to sort of think around this a bit, in that the initial waves, the geomagnetic waves, are there. They are then very sensitive people in the past found them in certain places.
Yes.
They then built temples or megaliths.
Yes.
Or whatever.
They have put markers on markers of the quality of energy.
All right.
They have put standing stone when the energy was ascending and making us ascend in our consciousness.
And the higher they built it, the stronger the wave became, or the
yes, of course.
It fell. So
of course.
Kind of a combination
yes.
between the geomagnetic forces and human sensibility.
Yes.
Sensibility
yes.
As well.
Yes.
But you also mentioned the Eiffel Tower.
You
mentioned about other buildings which maybe were not put in particular sensitive.
Well, what one thing. Thank you for the question. It's very, very important information. One thing I was able to make out from all the sites, you know, everything I studied, which is not everything, of course, but the little part of whatever monuments and architecture and all that I studied, was showing that the crossing that has been marked by the megalith people is stronger than any religion that is coming ongoing. The sacred site is always going to stay. Under the Cathedral of Paris, Notre Dame, you have a temple to Diana. And you have the pillar of the note. I was starting to tell you about the notes. Nautica, Nauticus, Navy. The notes were the sailors, the first inhabitants of Paris, the Parisians. And they were the notes. And when the Romans took over, gentlemanly, they erected a pillar with their own Gaulish gods, the Celtic, the Druidic, you know, Cernunnos and all this, and the Roman god and goddesses, eight of them, with making an identification of each Roman god or goddesses with a Celtic god or goddesses. And so they were kind of unifying the two religions at the moment the Romans took over. This pillar of the notes was in the underground of Notre-Dame de Paris, of the cathedral. Chartres, as I said yesterday, has an enormous astronomical temple that is certainly as beautiful as Stonehenge, but less large, but could be very, very interesting. That has been into reports from a notarial family of Chartres, the reports going on for three or four centuries of notaries in the same family, in family in which there was an architect that was called to check on the after a quake, an earthquake, to see if the foundations of the cathedral, like three centuries ago or four, and he discovered, and he's describing in this notarial journal, an arc of 12 menhirs under Chartres Cathedral, each one facing in an ellipse shape, and each one, the inside of each pillar was of each menhir was carved with runes, language, you know, the Scandinavian runes, sacred language. And so this was definitely an astronomical, they call it a calendar, you know, it's crazy. This is an astronomical temple, extremely sacred. And it so happened then I check a little more the architecture of Chartres Cathedral, and I realize I found very old. Some people were saying that they were complaining because at the very like two or three centuries ago, in order to get to the cathedral and pray, the people of Chartres were having to go through a staircase that was very steep. And this is the ground of the cathedral, this level. And you still have two levels of staircase. This is, we are talking about about this height, you know, something like 6 meters, 5-6 meters, you know, height. So you have ample room for a huge many, you know, maybe more. And this is what they call the crypt, which is at the level of the street, because this is a hill. Okay, this is a hill, this is a hill, this is a hill, okay. So it is covered up by the staircase and the fact you have a hill. So you say, oh, no. Because what they call the crypt, Saint-Fulbert crypt, is in fact very, very It's not large at all. It's only 5 meters here. I'm sorry, I don't know the exact width of the Cathedral of Chartres. It's the greatest, the biggest cathedral we have, nearly, the second one, I guess. But if you take this width for the cathedral, this is the width of what they call Saint-Philbert Crypt. One side on the other side, like and then three sides, like a horseshoe. All along the rectangle, on the small side, the opposite to the porch. So what is there that is not the crypt? And you can turn around, it's immense, the crypt. But it's only 4 meters large. And you know that the width of the cathedral is like, 120 meters. What is there in width and in height? And at that time, there was a Pope Gregory, because the first cathedral of Chartres and Paris, they were both built on previous churches, on previous Gallo-Roman temples, on previous megalith. We have, I don't know how many places where we know there is a megalith under the church in France, or they are on the side of the church.
I'm a bit lost. Where's the 12 pillars with the runes on it? Where are they?
Here.
Underneath, in that space you're talking about?
You are at the level of the ground.
Yeah.
Okay. You have an arc of 12 menhirs, that is like about 100 meters, 100 yards width. Okay, and you have 8 meters high, height. Okay, and around this, you have a tiny walkway that they call the Fulbert Crypt, which is only 4 meters, and which goes around like this, your immense cathedral. And this is 1.5 floor, height. And this is the width of the...
Can you visit the pillars, the runic pillars?
No, of course not. It does not exist.
Oh, no.
But is it like a man-made hill, then?
Eh?
It's like a man-made mound, which has buried the men here in... They're still stood there, like in the walls. And you've got the tiny space in the middle of the crypt, but your standing stones are like in the build, like in the walls, in the big, thick wall. Little hole in the middle, and Chartres dumped on top of it, built on top, and the stones are still.
Yes, the Pope Gregory had given advices and orders to the monks that came to Britain and Ireland, not St. Patrick, but another one, and he gave orders that no ancient temple was to be touched and destroyed, that they had, and there is a paragraph of something like, it's in, I found it in Watkins' book, by the way, and I have the citation in my book. So there is a paragraph, there is something like 8 or 10 lines, okay? And in this paragraph, which I analyze, 3 times it is mentioned, one way or the other, that they must not destroy and touch even the ancient altar, stone, whatever, you know, temple, whatever. They have to build around it so that, says the Pope, the followers and the faithful will still come to the same place and be able now to get to pray to the new, to the real true God. Say that again?
They built, when there was a fire in the 1100s that destroyed the first abbey, and then they raised, Abbot Beer raised the abbey above the ground level.
But do you know if in Glastonbury Abbey, do you know if you have some megalith under it?
It was the site of the Wattle Church, but the Wattle Church burned down during the fire. So they left the space there, but...
And they built around it. But about megalith, do you know if there are megaliths under?
Don't know. but it's water, the water level is...
You have streams.
There's a well, and the water level is just there.
So. Druidic place. De toute façon, it cannot not be. The place here is absolutely, we are in Glastonbury, the place is absolutely unbelievable. It's streaming with energy from the ground, from the cosmos. It's unbelievable. I am just like that all the time, you know. So, okay, so... I believe that if you allow me, let's take 5 minute break, and then we start again. Why? What was the deep reason why this sacred network was built in the first place? We saw the way it was regulating, enhancing the first grid of the geomagnetic grid, the geomagnetic field of Earth, which is, as we know, of course, magnetism and a part of electricity too. And and this grid is, of course, open also to all kinds of interferences with storms and water flows underground, water rivers above ground, and as well as mountains. And that's why the lines are rising with the mountain to the top, etc. But there was a deeper reason I came to understand that why this grid was first of all built was indeed to enhance and to stimulate the awakening of consciousness in human beings on Earth. The fact that we were at the time of the Celts gathering around a sacred stone for rituals, open-air rituals, and that, let's not forget that we're talking about a Western grid, but this is a very tiny part of an Earth grid, you know? So we have always to make the bridge with shamanic cultures. It's very important to understand that if we had a stone, but let's not, that there are an immense number of stones, standing stones, circles, underground chambers, table, megalithic artwork, as we know in everywhere in the world, including in Africa. We have a lot of standing stones, circles in Nubia, in all kinds of places. And I was recounting the one I discovered myself in the 70s in the Dogon country at the top of a hill, which was exact same megalith table with an under chamber, you know, where you could only sit like 6 or 7 people, and so large like the table was large like 2 meters 20, 2 yards 20. Well, this drawing is nice. I leave it. And at the there is a tradition that is coming from we know of it in Greece, we know also that all Greek philosophers, the greatest one we know of, the latest being all those Greek philosophers we know of, Plato and Aristotle and Pythagore, they all had been to Egypt. That's where they got, it was their university time was in Egypt. And that's where they got the initiatic knowledge of the Egyptian, from the Egyptian priest, about geometry, architecture, astronomy, and the sacred science, what we call in Sumer the sacred science of the gods. Including, if you remember, this absolutely extremely beautiful presentation from Peter Knight. In this presentation, the Megalithomania 2015, Peter Knight, you will find it on certainly YouTube. Yes? And you had this magnificent carving, which is in the Louvre Museum in Paris, of Inanna, Ishtar, as Lilith, as goddess, not only goddess of the night, but the goddess of magic, with two halls, and the signs of the gods of Sumer, which is the rod and the circle, you know, the ring on the rod. So I have in my book DNA of the Gods, I have gone through the tablets and notably the symbolism of that we have in the ancient Sumerian tradition on clay tablets that date like 2,500, 3,000 more BC. And we have the cross, we have the Ankh, we have the Star of David, we have the Flaming Cross that I drew before. So all these symbols are coming from Sumer. So the Greek philosophers, they got their science, the basics, and after they developed it, of course. They got the basics of certain sciences in Egypt, and Egypt was one of the two brothers that were the prince, the sons of the king of heaven, Nibiru. So basically the science that was in Egypt was also in Sumer proper, meaning Mesopotamia, the ancient Iraq, actually. And why were we, what was happening when, at the Druidic time, we were gathering in a clearing under a sacred tree or around a megalith, a standing stone, to have a ritual? So the megalith, the stone that is making the antenna, is exactly the same energy machine, I would say, than a huge millennia-old tree in a shamanic culture, or the tip of the hill of a mountain. In you know that all the rituals are happening at the top of mountains in Mexico and in Latin America. So the trees were known because they had a consciousness, and the mountains were known to have also a consciousness. And what was happening with some people gathering is that what was supposed to happen on the happening when on good occasions was that the people assembled there were getting into a shared consciousness that was like you know, especially with music and trance and dancing in all African and shamanic culture in South America and everywhere in Australia. And at that point, when we get to a shared consciousness, it's like this energy of consciousness is creating a field. It's creating a field, and you have to understand that this SIG energy is at the same time active information in itself, and also sets of frequencies that are really waves, you know. So it's a dynamical type of stuff that is not, as I said earlier, a carrier wave, but that is itself an energy of active consciousness, of a process, you know, in process. So basically, when we are gathered as a group to do the exact same thing, either to participate in a chanting or in a ritual or in a whatever trance, you know, they had in some culture, we harmonize the rhythm of this kind of energy of consciousness, this SIG energy. And when we get harmonized into the same rhythm, then we become like one shared mind. And our emotional, our whole body, body, psyche, mind, are also harmonized internally, and then we harmonize also with the other people. And that creates something very, very interesting, and that I took a very long time to understand, but I could observe because I have this gift that I am able to see this energy of consciousness, this SIG energy. For example, one day I was with, at one point, the first type of initiate I met in my life was a group of Orthodox, I mean Greek Orthodox, Celtic monks, you know. An order which was called, which was a Celtic Orthodox order, Saint Columban order in Brittany. And I got the information, and then I told my boyfriend, I was told we absolutely had to go and see this, these monks, you know, because they were making astral travel, they were, you know, and they were open in their community. And it was such an incredible experience that I lost my boyfriend, who just stayed there and became a monk. And I came back alone. 5 days later, I was back like to Paris and alone in my little old car. So, but I said, okay, he found his way, you know. He was only at the last year of his medical school. Like, he had 5 years behind and only one to finish. It was in the summer, he had only one, and he just, that's my way, I stay there. So, but those monks were unbelievable because they had the Celtic tradition. And they had become Orthodox so that they could be a little more free to do, to have their own way. And it was the most unbelievable order you can imagine, because nobody was, there was absolutely no law. They were making artcraft also, weaving carpets, making candles, and they said, okay, so here we don't have any rule, and if somebody is hungry, he goes to the kitchen, he makes food for everybody, and he calls the other ones telepathically. I said, well. And then I found a rock of meditation. And because I was, 19 at the time, And I felt that I had all those minds inside my mind, and I did not like it at all. And so I was so burdened that I wanted just to, I was writing poetry, meditating at the time. So I decided that I was going to go and find a rock, a meditation rock, where I could sit, read, smoke, and be with alone in my head, you know? And it so happened that I found this rock on the first morning, the next morning, we arrived at night. And I was on this rock, and at one point, I heard like, time for food. Very clear. And it was not the same as being burdened by the, when I got there. Okay, the afternoon, I go on my rock. Again, I mean, the night were wonderful there. We were discussing for hours. That was very nice. But the daytime, I could not bear this. I could not hear any specific thought. It was just like, you know, a kind of murmur with different voices, and it was making me crazy. And so I decided to go again on my rock to avoid this. I'm walking on a tiny little path, going to the field outside of the yard of the monastery, around the stone monastery, you know. And it had a little church with, of course, a dolmen inside. It's still well known, it's still a place of... I was asked not to give the name of this place. But I will make... because the monk, the oldest monk, there were only six monks, and the oldest monk was absolutely extraordinary. I mean, when I was feeling the maps of Brittany at that time, he was called Coulmer. And when I was feeling the maps, it was like the wall of Brittany in France was like a white field. And this was this guy. And he was an incredible mind. And so it's called Les Sept Saints, the seven saints. And it has a pilgrimage still. I heard, I discovered through the internet. But when I was writing this, he said, he asked me not to write the name so that it does not get published, so to speak. And so I am on this tiny path, and I'm trying to go to my absolutely fantastic rock, which was kind of a huge table, by the way, which was flat and overlooking a beautiful landscape, the field, you know, trees. When suddenly, so I'm like this, and it's only the second time I go. And suddenly, I have this burdening, you know, this murmur in my head. And suddenly, I make one more step, and plof, there is nothing in my head. I'm alone in my head. This is unbelievable. So I go back like this, one step, and the murmur is there. I cannot believe it. I make one step. I'm alone in my head. And there was, so I took a repère, you know, I took a marking on the vegetation. I put a stone. I said, this is unbelievable. I have to check this again. There was one specific boundary where inside, in the yard of the monastery, I was in their telepathic field. On one step, I'm outside of this telepathic field, and I'm alone in my mind. And on the way back, I take one step, okay. So I understood there was a boundary. At this, during these five days before I left, and I left my friend there, the first time, I could see a grid on the sky that was like a geodesic grid of gray, of course, there was a blue, it was full summer, there was a blue sky, and the grid appeared as gray, whitish, lines, and they were making some kind of rectangles, slightly curved, you know, and covering the whole sky I could see in the daytime. And I did not like that grid. I understand I'm 19, I am meditating since 1 year, 1 year and a half. I'm just very new, starting, I just have this vision. I don't, you know, like Coulmer when he took a kitchen glass, you know, to make the mass because they were very poor. And when he did the Eucharisty, when he uttered, you know, the Eucharistic ritual, I saw the kitchen glass with a coupe. It was like a cup, you know. And I saw this kitchen glass, which was suddenly lighted by just the intention on the prayer. It was it was very interesting. And I had also I did not like the grid because it was gray. You understand? Gray is not spiritual, so I did not like it. And it's only. So I left my friends and I finished my university bachelor degree, and then I was free to go where I wanted to go, which was India, since years and years I was waiting. And say that a year and a half later, I hitchhiking from Iran. A year and a half later, I am in Nasik, arrive in Nasik barefoot, no money, like a hippie hitchhiking. And in Nasik, I find a pilgrim house, a rope bed, you know, on top of the hill, on the sacred town, the sacred part of the city in Nasik, it's where they have the Kumbh Mela, is down next to there are baths, huge baths in the water, a bath for this sect, these sadhus, etc. And going down to the sacred part of the town, Nasik is near Bombay, it's not far from Bombay, not far from the Ellora Caves and the Ajanta Caves, which are very near, where my line, you know, remember the Mount Segur line, the last one was going to Ajanta, Ellora, and further. On this line was Kailash Mountain, the abode of the gods in three religions, Buddhism and Hinduism and Jainism. And the same thing happened. I was turning around the road, there was something like 250 meters, maybe 300 meters, going down to the first temple, you know, like hundreds of temples around the bath and the water. When turning in this tiny street, like 3 meters, you know, street, suddenly I make one pass and wow! I am in a, now I call it harmony field. Suddenly it's like past this limit. Everybody in this town, in the sacred part of the town, was like awaken, I like one share consciousness between everybody. So I'm like that, and I see only people that are like that. And it's like, of course, at that time I have no more problems, psychological problems. My mind is totally clear. I've been already in India since 6 months. I've been in Iran with a Sufi master. I'm meditating hours by day. So I have no internal murmur, you know. I'm clear. And I see that everybody is totally clear, and the energy of consciousness is bathing us, you know, like. So I call it a harmony field. And now I stay in Nasik, I don't remember how many days, and I stay all day long until after night comes in the sacred part, meditating in one place, in another place, bathing in this incredible harmony field. And I go back, climb up the hill, and when I pass in front of a specific tea shop, a chai shop, turning the little street, blung, it's finished. I'm back in. So it was exactly the opposite, you know. It's like. So at that time, I understood. And in the daytime, what do I see in the sky? The grid. The gray, whitish grid. The geodesic grid. Now I understand, because I know now it's not only telepathic, but in India, you know, the people are so clear, they don't have automatic thinking. They have a clear state of consciousness, especially the people that were living inside. They could be chai shop, whatever, eh? But they are all totally clear, you know, no automatic thinking. So they were all day long, all night long, even dreaming into this consciousness, collective consciousness field. And the grid was then the outer boundary, you know, of this grid. But I could see it only when I had the sky behind, because it was making a with a blue sky behind, I could see the gray whitish energy lines. So the very, very interesting point that made, it's a parenthesis, but that was extremely difficult for me to understand. And I ponder from the beginning, because I had those kind of anomalies, I would say, from first few dreams that were very important. And it's like there was definitely a kind of matter inside the consciousness and the spiritual layer. You see what I mean? It was not only just matter and just immaterial spirit. There was in the realm of what is very immaterial, there was a type of physics there that was not the same. It was not constrained by space, constrained by time, and constrained by the laws of electromagnetism, you know, or quantum whatever laws also, you know, random laws of quantum physics. So it was, and then I finally found the solution with my book on cosmology, my theory on the origin of the universe, which is called Cosmic DNA. If you look at Amazon, Chris H. Hardy, you will find Cosmic DNA. And this is why, because consciousness is a specific type of energy, which has also some laws, but are not the same as the laws of matter and electromagnetism. So it has a specific energy, which, as I said earlier, is faster than light, is working, it is consciousness in process, it is in active information, and it is also the way to spontaneously connect with harmonic minds or harmonic people that have the same values, feelings, and the connection. Our own higher self is connecting itself spontaneously to people that have resonant waves, you know, resonant SIG energy. Whether they are in values or whether they are in art, feeling, you understand. And then you connect, and then you are going to go walking through the street, and suddenly you meet the person. And you imagine you are meeting the person, you have never seen this person, but yet I have the impression I know this person. Where is it that? Because the connection was made in the realm, in the dream time, in the realm of your higher self, with a big S, like the Jungian self. And so there is a layer of your being at each instant, which is doing all kinds of connection without even, you don't need to be aware of that. But this is creating connection, creating links, creating events, taking you in this street instead of this one, making you late so that at precise moment you arrive there to meet this person. This is how it's weaving events. Eh?
Glastonbury time. It's famous for that reason.
Okay.
You take an hour to walk up the high street. It's unbelievable.
Okay.
You plan to go wrong when you come here, but
okay. So those fields of Sig energy. Then I made a whole framework to understand them, which is half of the book Sacred Network. And they have, so I pass over a few more stories that I explain how I came to understand them, what specific features were in that field, including one day that I was driving down a road going back to my home, a road that I knew since years, I was taking at any time of day or night. And that night I see, it was like, you know, dusk, and it was, I see something like a sphere, which is like much larger than the road. It's a tiny, you know, suburb, far suburb of Paris, very a valley, very nice, full of wood and with nice little houses. And I see this sphere that is larger than, I see like a quarter of it over the road, and I'm driving and I say, what is this? It looked like transparent. And I could not make out what it was. And of course it was not a light, a street light or whatever. And I said, but what is it? So I start pulling, you know, going very, very slowly. And then with my car, I say, no, it's okay. It does not seem to be dangerous. So I drive through it. And instantly, like the sphere was like, as I said, 15 meters maybe wide. And instantly, I am in an altered state, like boom. I said, that's very strange. There must be some people who have done an experience in the house next to it, and they created this sphere. Because this sphere of energy, and then it lasted a few hours, which was nice. But this kind of harmony field can be created whenever people are in a very deep harmonic state. They have harmonized their minds, they have harmonized their body by dancing, they have harmonized their rhythm by, you know, by the music, by the dancing, by just meditating together, hearing a concert, and then you create a field. But because this energy of consciousness is an energy, it has a specific physics to it. Even if it eludes totally the type of materialistic physics that we know of, but not quantum physics, that is a little more difficult. So basically you have a field that you have people together and a field that is created. And another example that is extremely talking, you say that in English? An example can be talking, no? Parlant en français, un exemple parlant, c'est-à-dire un exemple that is clearly showing an information. One day I was in Manali, northern India, and we were leaving a group of people together, and we were all of us meditating very, very many hours a day. And so we were like the ascetic, we had lost the necessity to speak. You know, we would stay in deep meditation state even after eating. And so that night, like any other night, we were like, it happened that we were four people, maybe another day, another number. And we had a stove behind, and it's just a little wooden room with a wooden balcony. And we are just four people, nicely, you know, maybe smoking a bidi or something. And at one point, so nobody was talking, everybody was nicely in one's own state, meditative state. And suddenly, it was like there was a flash of light, as I felt it. And suddenly, the four minds were like one mind. But for me, it had, of course, a visual, because I'm able to see this energy. So the visual was that suddenly there was a torus of light going through our foreheads. It was from the forehead and the head chakra. And we were, strangely, two men and two women, of all of us, each of us, very high already in meditation on in this path. And the forehead chakra were forming this torus that was of energy that was going at an incredible speed. So like, whoosh. But turning, I could see which way it was turning, inverted if you look above, counterclockwise. And then at the same moment that, so you have three things. You have the fact that suddenly, like, you are in the mind of all the other ones also. Then you have this torus, this rotating energy, you know, large like that, whitish, between the foreheads, the foreheads. And you have, I see a sphere, because I start looking at the room, and the room is totally transfigured, transformed. And it's all gleaming, and it has, as if I was inside a bubble, a soap bubble. And first I don't understand, but I see everything like silk, you know, taking the light like this, gleaming. And then I realize there is a sphere, and it has created this tiny field, has created around us the four people, has created a bubble of this same type of energy. And inside this bubble, we are all into one mind. And it's the same kind of bubble created by the monks in the monastery that was taking also the first field, the proper, you know, their yard, what I call the yard. It was like, I would say, 80 meters, plus the monastery, maximum 250 meters diameter, you know. And this one was very small. It was just surrounding four people sitting cross-leg on the floor. And these are the same type of energy field as the bubble created by the people on the road that I pass through. And I get into the bubble, and I am in the field of those people. But I am coming from the outside. You know, like in Nasik, I am from the outside of the field, and I step, and there is one step, ploof, I pass the mandari, and I am inside the field created by those people. So I call those fields Tela field, telepathic, harmonic field, Telha field. And this is going to be my conclusion. I believe, because I have also experienced those fields in all kinds of different, like in Goa, the trance dance, the techno music, I'm also for any kind of whatever is experience that is extremely anomalous and strong. I am always for it, and so you can get now in a. I would say that you can get in a techno trance party. You can get 5,000 people, 20,000 people, for example, for the millennia, for the turn of the millennia, we had gigantic parties, and we had 5,000 people or more, you know, in the same state. And one bubble in one party in one place is connecting with another bubble because the energy is exactly the same. This is the energy of the turn of the century. It has a very specific print, and you will have the print inside the music that has been recorded at that time. And while you were inside the field, we had transduction. I don't know. You have to invent words, concept. So I call them this and that. And it's like suddenly, you know, we had connection with another party in Australia, and then another one in Nigeria. And it was like each bubble was connecting with the other one with the exact same kind of energy of this feast of the turn of the century. So those fields, it's like we are getting to a higher level of harmony and frequencies, mind frequencies, while including, this is totally, it's new for our epoch. It was the science of the shamanic and trans people, you know, all those cultures that have that had the form of trance, which was most of them, they knew how to put their body and their emotional psyche inside the trance. And we had lost totally the touch with our bodies and with the earth. It's only since the 70s that we are getting back to understand those possibilities, you know, those potentialities. And so you are harmonized with the body, with a rhythm, because it's very easy to harmonize on a rhythm when you dance. And then slowly the energy is going up, and then you can drive it, and then it becomes a very, very interesting field that is able spontaneously. The laws of harmonic resonance spontaneously connect with other stellar fields that have the same quality at the same time. So I believe that this is a very, very... this is maybe why the network of megalith has been implanted like needles, like acupuncture needles, on the earth. And you know, this is the same word in Chinese for the point of acupuncture, point on the body, on the body of the earth. It's the same, you know, it's the same name. This is why the megalith network was created. It's because they were acupuncture points, not only for the earth, but for consciousness, whatever species with consciousness, and also the animals that we don't recognize as conscious, but that are conscious. And it was like awakening our consciousness, and it was like stimulating our consciousness until we reach the age that has been predicted by Teilhard de Chardin, philosopher, by Carl Jung, that we are now getting to the age where the leap that we are getting into is a leap in collective consciousness. So we are getting conscious of this Sig energy. We are getting conscious of the print, the Sig imprinting in object, you know? Synchronicities, when you start experiencing synchronicities, it's because you are connected with your self, you know? And the self is making the connection and proof, it appears as a synchronicity. So this is it. This is, I believe, our next leap that we have already started. Thank you very much. Yeah.